morning that you've heard me preaching on over and over and over again. It's like, you know, you got a default message. You know, it's like Dan Moeller. You push his button and love comes out. You know, there's a default message that's there. And I know that's true, but it's important. Because at some point along the line, I realized how vital identity is to this whole deal. And without that piece right there, it's nothing more than religious performance. Because all we end up doing is we spend all of our energy and our effort and our strength trying to become something that He already did for us by grace the moment that we got saved. And so energy and striving and praying more and reading the Bible more, all of that trying to arrive at something that was a gift to begin with. Jesus is still the only door to real, lasting, permanent heart-level change in our lives. And he's not just the door, He's the hinges. As you and I cross over into 2013, it all hinges on this one thing, knowing who that you are in Christ. Who are you in Christ? I think sometimes maybe I talk about this too much, and I know I've preached on some other things lately, but I think maybe I talk about this too much, but then I'll get around people and I realize still most people don't get this. It shouldn't be rare. This is like the foundation of the thing. And yet it is. It's like you hang around people, or you go on the guilt trip, you go on vacation and you spend time with family, or you go on the holidays with family or whatever, you're meeting people and you're in a different group, and it's like, woo, there's no connection when it comes to that whole idea about identity. So I really want us to talk about that a little bit this morning, because new beginnings require clear endings. Now that's no truer than anywhere else than it has to do with our own identity in Christ. See, the moment that you were born again, something radically amazing happened. Now, right now, across the world, at least in America, millions and millions of people are going to be formulating a plan about how they're going to change for the new year. They're going to, whether it was the new stair stepper they got for Christmas, or it's a, you know, a new DVD video of a weight loss program, or whatever it may be, how to quit smoking in 21 days, or whatever. There's a plan that's being formulated in the hearts of people across America to try to work their way into a different place in their own personal lives. And thank God that they desire change. Thank God that there's a hunger for that. But the truth is, if we do it outside of our own identity of who we are in Christ, it's nothing more than works. It's just religion. It's just willpower. It's just trying to do things by our own efforts. Now, the moment that you were born again, you know, I'm just bear with me. I'm going to ramble today. That's why people in some churches, they get saved over and over and over again. Because really, to them, that salvation experience is nothing more than a second chance. It's okay, God, now you're going to give me another chance to try to do better than I did last time. Last week I did it this way, I messed it up, and so I'm going to come and get saved again and come to an altar, pray the prayer again, so that you can give me another chance. As if being born again was nothing more than another chance to do it right again. It's nothing to do with simply a matter of a second chance. The moment that you were born again, that word in John chapter 3, it means, you'll see some translations, born from above. Well, what is it from above that we're born from? The original identity, the original source, it's the identity, it's the source, it's the nature of Jesus Christ. You're born into sonship. You're born into an identity that whatever is true of Jesus is now true of you. Say that with me. Whatever is true of Jesus is now true of me. Say it again. Whatever is true of Jesus is now true of me. That's what happens the moment that we get born again. We get the life and the identity of the original source, born from above, the seed of God, the person of the resurrected Jesus Christ. So that the Scripture can say in Ephesians chapter 1, I got in Ephesians chapter 1 the other day, I started in verse 1. You know, Paul, an apostle by the will of God, to the saints, and I couldn't get past saints. Saints. This whole thing about being born again, Ephesians chapter 1, it goes on and it says that you, because you are in Christ, you are already holy. Now that messes with people. And some of you have been here a while, you know I say it all the time. Read the book. Ephesians chapter 1. Is Christ holy? Is Christ blameless before the Father? Is Christ blessed before the Father? The reason that you are holy and blessed and blameless is not because of anything that you have done. It's your identity, because you are in Christ and Christ is blameless and holy and blessed. That's who you are. You are a son or a daughter who is holy, who is blessed, who is blameless before God in Him. If you're in Christ, whatever is true of Him has now become true of you. See, the moment that you were born again, God gave you an eternal wedgie. That's like not the image you wanted for Sunday morning. What do I mean by that? I mean God placed a wedge the moment that you were saved, the moment that, according to Ephesians chapter 1, that you believed the truth of your salvation. And the moment that you believed, you became something. In that moment, the Bible is teaching us that there was a wedge that was driven between who you were and who you are. And eternally, forever, this wedge has been driven down so that this old life will never, ever define you again. Never. Who you are in Christ will define you forever. The problem is that we spend most of our time still trying to define ourselves according to what God has eternally separated us from. New beginnings require clear endings. And what we're doing, a whole lot of our Christian experience, is we're doing nothing more than dressing up a corpse. We're trying to change an old person that doesn't even exist anymore. We're trying to dress him up and... You know, you go to a, and I hope nobody's been to a funeral. I'm not trying to make light of it, but you go to a funeral and you have a lifeless body there. And in honor, that's great. We put them in a tie and a suit or a dress, and we dress them up real nice so that we've got good memories of that person. The last time that we see them is there and dressed up real pretty, but they're not there. They don't even exist in that body anymore. And yet, we, in that case, end up spending the rest of our life honoring a person who's not there. When we see them in the grave, and we're honoring them only by our memories, because we can't hold on to really anything else but our memories. And in our memories, we're reminded of a person who doesn't exist anymore in that form. That's what we do in our salvation. We spend all of our time from the moment that we're born again, we're moving forward and we're looking back and we're remembering this old person as if that person still exists, and in our minds we're keeping them alive. And we're trying to fix up an old life that's already gone. And the reason that we're not growing and moving forward is once we get past the zeal and once we get past that place of thankfulness and love for forgiveness, which of course should be all the time, but that new conversion zeal, and then we move past that and that's not driving us anymore, if we're not rooted in the truth of who we were and now who we are, we'll start trying to fix up that dead person, trying to make it better so we can be a good Christian. Are you following me this morning? New beginnings require clear endings. I know that this is the case when it comes to Scripture. I know for me, the way that I interpreted Scripture. I mean, when you live from the mindset that you're still trying to arrive at something that God already says you've arrived at, you'll look at the Scriptures and you'll begin to interpret them through the lens of the old man, and you'll find every Scripture in there that has to do with how you'll interpret it and twist it to make it about you and how you've got to shape up in order to be right with God. I know I did this with Hebrews chapter 4. I love the book of Hebrews. High priest, we were talking about that this morning in pre-service prayer, and Mark was talking about even our offering today. Jesus is the great high priest. Amazing book. It's an awesome book. But how many of you, I don't know if you did this, but I sure did it. As a pastor, in the beginning, I'd read Hebrews chapter 4. You know the Scripture. For the Word of God is living and powerful, and it's sharper than any two-edged sword, piercing to the division of soul and spirit and joints and marrow, and is a discerner of the thoughts and the intents of the heart. And there's no creature hidden from His sight, but all things are naked and open to the eyes of whom we must give account. Man, I'd read that passage and I'd preach it too. The only time I'd read it was when I was going to preach it, because I really didn't want to look at that Scripture for me, because every time I read that, because the verse right before it talks about disobedience. And so I'd preach that. I'm telling you, and I'd say things, you know, probably like this. I'm here today and I'm preaching the Word of God to you, and it's sharp and powerful, and I'm telling you this morning, you can't hide. It doesn't matter what kind of sin that you're in today, no matter what kind of things that you've been going through, God's going to find out. It's going to be shown right there. God's going to expose your sin. I mean, that's how I used to preach that. I mean, it stirs people up. It'll get you going. You know, I always wonder why, you know, people who have this, and I was one of them, it's like this kill me mentality, like, come on, preach it, that hurts really bad, come on, give me some more, step on my toes. But I didn't read the rest of the passage. I stopped right there. I interpreted it through the lens of, here's a passage about the Word, and it has to do with your disobedience, Chuck. There's another verse after this. Seeing. By the way, the context is about the disobedience of not believing the gospel. It's about them they're having an evil heart of unbelief and not believing the truth of the gospel of their salvation and what the good thing that God has done in their lives. And then he goes from the Word of God living, what word? It's the word of the gospel. The gospel has this capacity. The context is about rest. The Word of God comes sharp as a two-edged sword and exposes inside of us whether we're resting in the gospel or we're trying to get there by our own efforts. That's why he goes into the very next verse and he says, verse 14, seeing then that we have such a great high priest who's passed through the heavens, Jesus, the Son of God, let's hold fast our confession. For we do not have a high priest who cannot sympathize with our weaknesses, but he was in all points tempted as we are, yet without sin. Let us therefore come boldly to the throne of grace, that we may obtain mercy and find grace to help in time of need. He's saying, look, guys, The Word of God is going to expose, the gospel is going to expose whether you're resting in the finished work of Christ or whether you are trying to, by your own efforts, have relationship with God. And he said there's going to come a time where, yes, we're all going to give an accounting. Some of us are going to give an account for what we did. Some are going to give us an accounting of what he did for us. And that God sees our weaknesses. God knows all the way down to the discerning, to the very motives of our heart. He knows where we failed, but Jesus, on your behalf, didn't fail. And for you, he didn't just go into the holy place and the holy of holies. He did not just go there and in some separate way so that one day you can come up here and be good like me, like I am. No, he's your representative. He represents mankind. He represents the believer as the great high priest. And he stepped in by his very nature of being the Son of Man and the Son of God. He stepped into that holy place, carrying you with him into that place. And so he says, now, we just want you to know. Because if you will take a look at Jesus, you can know no matter what is going on there, there's a rest for you. And it's in the rest of already being carried in by Jesus himself. But see, friends, if we are coming from the perspective of not understanding who we are and what he's done for us, then we will be spending worship times or our prayer times trying to arrive at a place of getting into the presence of God. Everything in our lives, every scripture that we read will be twisted and interpreted in the wrong way because we didn't allow a clear ending to our old identity so that we could have a true new beginning in our new one. See, a lot of people, a lot of us, all of us, we're all walking through this. We look at our lives and we look and we say, I'm doing good here, I'm doing good here, I'm doing good here, but I've got this one area that hasn't been changed yet. Or maybe there's two or three, but well, for purpose of illustration, we'll just say that you've got one. And we look at that one area and we say, that area has not been changed yet. We see ourselves in a negative way in that area of our lives, though we see ourselves in a good way in the other areas of our lives. That is still so much about performance and works. See what I did good over here, God, and I'm a good boy over here, but I'm a really bad boy in this area right here. You're not a halfling. I've been looking for a place to use that. Go, Hobbit, yeah. You're not a halfling. You're not half old creation, half new creation. Three-fourths of you didn't get born again with one-fourth of you that did. There is the truth is that when you were born again, a wedge came in. Old is gone. Behold, some things have become new. All things, is the Word of God true or not? All things have literally become new in our lives. But the problem is that if we still see that area as untouched by the gospel, then it stays unchanged. Let's just say maybe it's you're going after overeating, or we could even talk about porn or whatever. It doesn't matter. It's the same in every area. And some people they might be offended by what I just said. It's like porn. Ooh, this is the really bad thing over here. But overeating, it's just a thing I got to deal with. Both of them are rooted in an identity problem. Both of them are coming from the same source, the same problem, the same vision, the same eye of seeing ourselves according to something that's not true. And so you say, well, I'm going to do better about eating and not overeating this year. And so you get a stair stepper, you join the gym at your local gym, and you get some accountability partners, maybe if it's porn or you get a workout part, whatever it may be. And really what you're doing is you want all these other things to try to help motivate you to change you into something that you don't believe that you are already. Now thank God for people who help. Thank God for somebody who's going to encourage you. That's fine. But the problem is for us is looking at that area of our life and saying that area of life has not been born again. That what God says about me is not true about that area. Because when we're struggling in one of those areas, whether it's porn or overeating or I don't know what it is, whatever it may be, you can look at that and forget that in that area of your life, according to the truth of the Word of God, you are free. You are free. We're waiting to get free. We're waiting for God to show up in a special service and or somebody come and cast a demon out of us or, you know, whatever it may be. But friends, somebody can cast a demon out of you all day long, but if you still believe you're in bondage, it's just going to go around the block and come right back around and hang out because you haven't changed your mindset. The truth is, you are free in the gospel. Sin shall not have dominion over you, for you're not under law, you're under grace. And when you believe the truth, you're experiencing freedom. It's crazy when you look in I think it's 1 Corinthians. I know I've used this illustration before, but it's probably no more appropriate than it is right now in this particular context. And Paul is dealing with a group of men in Corinth who are still going to the temple prostitutes. Saved men. Saints in Corinth that are going to the temple prostitutes. Talk about pornography. They had a porn problem there too. His solution to them was not to kick them out of the church. That's what happens a lot of times in churches today. His solution wasn't to kick them out of the church. His solution was this. He said, don't you know that you're the temple of the Holy Spirit? And God dwells inside of you? Don't you know that when you go to a prostitute, that you're carrying Christ into the act of joining yourself to one that you're not married to? Christ in the person was brought into the sin of adultery and prostitution. His solution was for them to understand who they were and who was inside of them, and that was what was going to break them free from what they were doing. It's your identity in Christ and who's in you that breaks you free from the habits like that that are pulling you away from your relationships and what God has ordained for you to walk in purity. It's about identity. It's about who you already are in Christ instead of trying to become something in order to get free. I know all of you are great Shakespeare fans. Romeo and Juliet. Juliet speaking to Romeo says the phrase that we've heard, what's in a name? That which we call a rose by any other name is just as sweet. Would smell as sweet. You keep thinking that you're the manure, you're going to smell like it too. You keep thinking that and you miss the truth that no matter what you call yourself, God calls you a rose. And to walk in any other identity is not going to make it untrue. It's just going to affect you. The only battle that we have in regard to identity is one that's in our own heads. Your battle is not with the Lord. Oh God, I'm trying to become holy. God, I need your blessings. I need your blessings, God. I'm going to fast and pray for your blessing. Your battle's not with the Lord. He's like, okay, you're in Christ, you're blessed. The battle is not with the devil. The more you focus on him, the more you empower him through fear that's going on in your own heart. And he certainly is going to be coming against you in opposition to your identity. You think that you're somehow, that we are somehow not going to be touched by that? Jesus, what is it that he, if you are the Son of God, then do this. He was pulling on his identity. After having just been affirmed by the Father, heaven opened up, and the Father said, that's my boy right there. That's my son in whom I'm well pleased. That's my boy. Woo, I love my son. And the first thing the devil says is, if you're really the Son of God, your battle's not with the devil. The battle is that in every one of us, we tend to, I think it was James Richards that said something like this, our battle is an imaginary battle that we're fighting in our own mind that doesn't even exist to try to fix up someone who's already died. And so we struggle and fight and jump and curse the darkness and beg God and all this stuff's going on and God's just waiting for us to finally get tired and quit and admit that old man died 20 years ago, 25 years ago, last year, whatever yours may be. The Bible says that you are the fragrance of Christ. New beginnings require clear endings. I was listening to Dan Moeller. I got some Dan Moeller for Christmas. I'm so happy. Those of you who don't know who he is, look it up on YouTube or you look up the sermon he preached here a couple of weeks ago. He's part of our covering for our church. And Dan Moeller, I was listening to him. And those of you who know him, this will make a little bit more sense. But the reason that he lives the life that he lives is not because he got like a special salvation. You know, it's like God reached down and said, oh, Dan, wow, Dan is more special than everybody else. And so when I anoint him, he's going to be really, really special. No. The secret to his love and his passion and his life, as I've been listening to him, talking to him personally over the last few years and asking him personally that question, the secret to Dan Moeller's life is his communion with God. Because here's what happens with Dan Moeller. Here's what happens with most of us. Most of us, we take communion and confession with God back into our identity in the old man. And we're praying about how the many things that we want God to change in us. And we're begging and fasting trying to fix that old man. And Dan steps in and God teaches him how to commune with God according to his identity and who he is in Christ right now. And his prayer time is a whole lot about thanksgiving. Because thanksgiving is about something that's already happened. We're thanking God for something that has been accomplished. Something that he's already done. Something that he's done through the blood that we sang about this morning. The secret place is the secret of Dan's communion. But it's not just of his life. It's not just, you know, just generic, you know, prayer. Here's what as I'm listening to him and he's teaching me and talking to him personally, this is why Dan lives the life that he lives. And we're talking, for those of you who don't know him, we're talking about a guy, how many of you guys know who Todd White is? You know who Todd White is? Well, Todd White, this is Todd White's mentor. This is the one who taught Todd White literally everything he knows. Dan used to tell me this, we'd be riding in the car and he would tell me part of the reason that Todd, you know, exploded and all this stuff has to do with him imitating some of these things in Dan's life. But literally, he would take Dan's sermons and he would go preach places and preach them word for word in the beginning everywhere he went. He didn't know anything else, didn't know any other Christianity other than what Dan was teaching him. And so the man that he is now and all the miracles and, you know, all the different things that are happening is because he didn't just imitate, he imitated his sermons until it became his, and they imitated his life, including his communion. See, when Dan prays, it looks like this. He's praying present tense. He's praying in thanksgiving. He's praying in confession before the Father. Now, a lot of times when we do confession is we have something that we've got a list of truths that we're going to confess before God that are true. And really what we're doing is we're confessing them to the air. It's like we're talking about them separate from relationship. We just start talking about these things like we're to the devil, or, you know, it's like totally absent from God at all. But Dan takes those very same confessions that we read about, like in Ephesians chapter 1, and he begins to personalize them before God in the present tense. And he begins to speak those things as they are. Because here's the truth of the Word of God. Ephesians chapter 2, verse 8, 9, 10, and following. For by what are you saved? For by grace you're saved through what? Oh, really? So your salvation and everything that's attached to it comes by grace, but it comes through your faith. Faith, remember guys, faith is nothing that you believe in order to make something true. We believe something because it already is true. So Dan begins to pray, and when he's in communion with the Father, it is in you should take notes on this because you're going to need this. It's in thanksgiving in the present tense, not was, not will be, in the right now. In terms of I am statements. It's in faith in the truth, because that's how we're saved. It's in communion, because it's in relationship. And it's by grace, because that's the only way heart level change happens in our lives. He says it like this, something along these lines. I'm trying to misparaphrase. When we declare in communion with God who we are by faith and thanksgiving, the Holy Spirit comes by grace and molds us into the very thing that we're saying. When we speak by faith in thanksgiving in the present tense about what He has done and who I am, that truth in communion with God, the Holy Spirit comes to fashion us into the very thing that's true about us in the Spirit already. Dan Muller's not a super Christian. Those of you who know him, I mean, when he comes and you hear the stories, the amazing things that happened through his life, he's not a super Christian. He's just a Christian who caught something. Who caught the truth and began to believe it. It's like the word, I mean, I'm getting close to being done. I'm speaking future tense, not present tense. Even the word, we say we're in Christ. The word Christ, Christos, anointed one, anointing, Crisco. I was born anointed. Do you know that you will not find a passage in the New Testament where anybody was praying for more anointing? It's not in there. The Bible says in John said, you have an anointing from the Holy One. Are you in Christ? Then you're anointed. But what we do is we live according to the old man as what has, as if it's not happened. And we're saying, oh God, I want to just walk in your anointing. I need to be anointed with the Holy Ghost and power. And we're praying for more anointing over dead flesh about somebody who doesn't exist, waiting for it to happen in the future, instead of saying, Father, I just want to thank you that I'm in Christ today. And that in Christ, I am in the anointed one. And I wake up every day in the anointing, and I just want to thank you for that today. Now you start talking like that, and stuff will start happening. I started praying, I told you in Ephesians the other day, I think it was, just a few days ago I was praying, and I got stuck at Saint, because I got to Saint, and all of a sudden I said, God, I want to thank you that I'm a saint before you, and then I got stuck there, because my whole past Bible training life was all about, well, you know, the word saint means to be set apart, and you were belonging to the world and belonging to the devil, and now you belong to God, and you're completely His. And that sounds very technical and true. But God separated me from my old identity. He drove a wedge between my old identity and who I am now, and nobody has the ability to put me back in that old life again. To be a saint has been completely set apart from something unto someone whose name is Jesus Christ. So I'm praying that the other morning, and you know, far be it from me to eat at Chick-fil-A for lunch. It just, you know, just so happened. Those of you who don't know, I'm a little bit of a fanatic. Yeah, a little bit fanatic when it comes to Chick-fil-A. My cell phone has I Love Chick-fil-A on the back of it. But so I'm in Chick-fil-A, and I walk up to the counter, and the lady says, can I take your order? And I notice that her hand she's wincing because she just did something. Her hand's all wrapped up, and I looked at her, and I said, yeah, you can take my order, only if you'll let me pray for you. And she's like, oh, yeah, I'd love to. I'd love for you to pray for me. And so I just took 5 seconds to pray for this lady. And I have no idea if she got healed. Because in 5 seconds, the power of God hit the lady in the Chick-fil-A. She's behind the counter, and she gets whacked, man. She's like, whoa, whoa. And she can't take my order. She can't take my money. All she can do is just go, whoa, that's good. And the part that messed me up, though, talking about identity, is finally when she gathered herself, she looked at me and she said, are you an evangelist? No, she said, who are you? Are you an evangelist? Are you some kind of pastor or something like that? Or are you just a Christian? And it messed me up for a minute. Because most of the time I don't tell people I'm a pastor, because people they'll say, oh, you just did that because you have to, because it's your job or it's what. I want people to know this is what everybody does. This is what it means to be a Christian. And she may have had the right connotation when she said it, but when she said, are you just a Christian, it messed me up for a minute, because she was making these distinctions between the two. And what I wanted to say was, no, I'm just in Christ, and it's His anointing, because it was. Let me finish with this. Well, let me read to you. I'm almost finished. See, I got the Dan Muller anointing. Oh, Jesus, help me. Yay, God. what was it? Did you get it? Did you get it? Um, Oh, God, the gospel's so good. You know, I was just, because I just wrote down and I wanted you to just hear the language, because you and I need to begin to embrace the language of communion that way. Things like, Father, I thank you today that I'm in Christ and Christ is in me. And Father, I bless your name and I thank you that you made me a saint. You separated me from my old life. I'm not a drug addict anymore. I don't struggle with those things anymore, because that's not who I am. I am dead to sin, but I'm alive to you forever in unbroken fellowship. And I want to thank you for what you did by grace in my life. And you just keep talking to God like that. Personalized. Not saying things without there being any connection to heaven, but in relationship, let these things be spoken out of your heart. And the more that you say those things, the more the Holy Spirit comes and He begins, you not only are declaring them by faith, and that doesn't mean, you know, when somebody says, I'm just speaking it by faith, what they mean is, I don't believe it yet. That's really what that means most of the time. I don't mean that kind of by faith. I mean you separate yourself in your heart from your own emotions. And let the wedge, because we don't live according to the wisdom of this world. The wisdom that comes from below is sensual and demonic and earthly. Earthly means without the Spirit. And sensual means to be living by your feelings. And we don't live according to our feelings. We don't live according to demonic wisdom. But the truth of the Word of God is this, and I declare it in spite of what I feel, and God begins to shape it in my life and make it real. Make it powerful. I'll finish with this. Is the real finish. The psalmist spoke a number of times. Psalm 63, I think maybe around verse 9, somewhere right in there. Other places about meditating on his bed. And wasn't too terribly long ago, I recognized that I was not being a really good receiver. I preach about it, but I wasn't doing a good job. People, people would say stuff and you'd say, oh, thank you, but your heart really doesn't buy it. You really don't believe it. And so I recognized that. Holy Spirit started showing that to me. Okay, you're preaching that, but are you doing that? I said, okay, God. And so at night on my bed, each night I would, in the present tense, because the Bible says in Hebrews chapter 8 that God is writing His laws on our heart. Not the law, laws. It's the law of the Spirit of life in Christ Jesus. It's the law of the royal law of love. God's not writing the Ten Commandments on your heart. He's writing new covenant realities on our hearts. The problem is, sometimes we're not cooperating with what He's trying to do in writing on our hearts. And so I said, God, I see that I'm not being this kind of receiver that I need to be. And I'm not believing things that I ought to be believing. And so each night before I would go to bed, I'd just write out this sentence, because I'm writing it on paper. God's writing it on my heart, because I want to cooperate with heaven. And I just wrote these words. One sentence that said this. Something along these lines. I am a good receiver from God and people. That's it. Not a big deal. I did not pray one time about that. I didn't intercede about it. I didn't tell anybody, including my wife. Didn't tell anybody. About 2 weeks into this, probably not even that long, but probably a week into it, as I'm in my bed, I am a good receiver from God and people. I'd write that, and in the morning when I'd wake up, I'd see that. I'd see with my heart that truth. Telling nobody, out of the blue, people from everywhere start coming and writing me notes, Chuck, I just want to thank you for doing this. And I appreciate that you're this. And somebody send me a Facebook post. And somebody, I'm talking about unsolicited, everywhere, affirmation just went like an explosion coming at me. It was a little bit weird. You know, it was not like you got some big TV show and thousands of people know you and they're all writing and, you know, you're famous. It was just like all of a sudden, every direction, letters and phone calls, people walking up to me. I mean, everywhere, affirmations started coming from every direction. And it took me a little bit to catch on to what was happening because I wasn't a good receiver. And then I recognized it. Oh. And then it dawned on me, I had not prayed one time about that. But God started to release all this stuff coming into my life. I had to receive it. It came out of my heart determining to come into agreement that He's trying to write this on my heart. And He stirred up the ranks to send every bit that I needed to begin to teach me that lesson without me praying a single prayer. Why am I telling you that? Don't nobody call me today. And Pastor, you're awesome. No, you can tell me. It's okay. I receive it. I receive from the Lord and from others. Okay. That's right. I'm still learning the lesson, Lord. But that's not why I'm telling you. The reason that I'm telling you is this. When you start living like that and speaking like that from your heart in communion before God in the present tense with thanksgiving about who God already says that you are, God is so passionate about you getting it, He will stir up a nation. He will stir up your workplace. He will stir up people to come and bring those truths into your life. He is so committed to backing up the work of His Son. He's passionate about His Son. And you getting the fullness of what His Son purchased for you. So I'm going to ask you to stand this morning. And I just want you to take a moment. We're not going to have everybody run to the altar. I want you to bow your heads for a moment, and I want to ask that between you and God, what is the truth, if there's a singular truth that you struggle with seeing yourself in some area of your life, that your perspective has been that, yeah, that's an unredeemed area, when God's saying, you're holy. Now, live out of holiness. Live out of what I've already done for you, and it'll change that area. What's the truth about you that's been locked away, that's been neglected, that you've not been receiving, that as you cross over into 2013, it'd be awesome if that truth were to be written on your heart to where you were confident that you were accepted in the Beloved, or that you were blessed with every spiritual blessing in heavenly places because you're in Christ, or that you are holy, or that you are blameless in His sight because you're in Christ. What is the truth? Maybe some other one. What is the I am present tense truth that you need to begin to confess in relationship and thanksgiving by faith before the Lord, so that as you move into the new year, grace comes in the new year and makes you into the person that you are, in fact, in Christ. Father, I want to thank you for the spirit of revelation that's here in this room this morning. the spirit of wisdom and revelation and the knowledge of you. And as Paul prayed for the church in Ephesus, as Brittany even read the scripture this morning, that the eyes of our understanding would be enlightened, the eyes of our hearts would be enlightened, that you would cause us to see you and see who we are in you. That the eyes of our understanding would be enlightened. God, that we as a corporate body and we as individuals would know what is the hope of your calling. What are the riches of the inheritance that's a deposit inside of every saint in this room? Your inheritance. And God, what is the exceeding greatness of your power that's towards every one of us as we believe the truth of who you are and who we are in you? Cause this new year and cause us as believers to see how new we are in you in this new year. I bless the saints in this room to experience what you say they already are. And as we prayed in pre-service prayer, God, I just want to thank you for the wisdom that you planned all this out way before, that in Christ we would have everything that we needed. And in your prudence and in your wisdom, you knew exactly what it was going to take for me to walk in freedom. And you said it was in Christ. And you destined me that in Christ I would be free. And I ask, God, that because it's your good pleasure to give us the kingdom, and it was in your pleasure that you made us to be a part of Christ, I ask, God, that with great delight that you will back up the confession of every saint in this room in this new year, so that your joy and our joy are both fulfilled. And I thank you for it in Jesus' name. And everybody said, amen. Thank you for coming this morning.